So welcome to this edition of Chat with Chairs, Budget at FICCI. It's a great pleasure for us to have today Mr. Rajiv Dimri, who is the head taxation from KPMG. He is also the co-chair of the FICCI Taxation Committee. Welcome to this edition, Rajiv, and it's great to have you with us. So the budget 2021 has been seen by many as a trend setter in different manner. Before I get to the direct taxation issues where, you know, it's the fine print of the budget, if I could just get some opening comments about the budget and overall sense of the budget and what it would do for the economy.
Thank you, Dilip. Happy to be here and great talking to you. It is, you know, almost like a cliche now to say that the presentation of this budget has been at times which are completely unreal. None of us, even while we're going through it, realize the full impact of it. And given the surrounding environment in which this budget has been presented, I think a great balance has been done, particularly from a tax perspective, when no new tax has been introduced. I think has been a great relief to the country, and we have all seen the reaction that how the industry has welcomed this budget. So given the extremely challenging times that we have, particularly from a tax collection perspective, staying focused and not introducing tax is to me the biggest feature that must be noticed, must be applauded in this budget. So that would be, from a tax perspective, tax professional perspective, would be my biggest takeaway from this budget, and kudos to that.
So if I were to take this forward, during our interaction with the finance minister, one of the comments that Dr. Arvind Lal had made at that meeting, and it was followed up, was this whole issue relating to the tax treatment of goodwill. You know, as a direct tax, as a tax practitioner, how do you see this there, and what are some of the challenges that would be faced, and how could we address them?
So from a corporate tax perspective, as you are already hearing, this is one of the most debated and perhaps, you know, hotly debated and controversial amendment that they have proposed. To say that suddenly we will start treating goodwill as more like a real estate, which never depreciates like land, it always appreciates, may be true in certain circumstances, but I don't think it is true in most other circumstances. A lot of M&A activity today happens for a variety of reasons. I may be buying your business not to continue using your goodwill, but to actually take you out of the market. And a lot of transactions of that type happen. And therefore, situations where in all case of an M&A activity, goodwill will forever be used and the name will keep rising. I think that assumption is true only under certain circumstances, but in wide variety of circumstances, it is not true. So therefore, I don't fully agree with the logic. Yes, if there is a change proposed in the law, yes, that's the, you know, the prerogative of the legislature. They can change the law. I would strongly recommend that change of law should only apply for transactions going forward. If this law is going to impact transactions that were done 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years ago, and those claim of depreciation are still eligible, I think that tantamounts to a retrospective amendment, which we all agree that should, under normal circumstances, not happen. We as a country have had our own share of, you know, debates on that retrospective amendment. I think this law, while I don't, you know, object to the go forward logic, but I certainly feel that it should not apply retrospectively. And therefore, perhaps the solution could be that for transactions arising after April 1, 2021, if there is a goodwill generated, that would not be eligible for depreciation. Perhaps that's the way via media where the government gets to implement its objective, not disrupting the past, would be my strong recommendation.
Right. So, So basically, you know, grandfathering those transactions that have actually happened, and looking at, okay, if there are one or two cases which are obviously have maybe done to circumvent the law, those can be looked at. But, you know, generally grandfather everything and have trust in the taxpayer.
And there are specific laws, Dilip, to deal with those exceptional cases where it is a clear case of, you know, some artificial arrangement. That certainly is possible. But to say we will treat everybody in the same footing, I think is not fair.
Okay. So the other very hotly debated topic in this budget was the thing related to this whole e-commerce transactions. Basically, fundamentally, the government is grappling with the challenge of, you know, how people could use electronic means, even a SMS or something, and use different methods of payment and circumvent the payment of taxation, payment of import duty, payment of GST, etc. And, you know, how do you look at that, the ECS and, you know, the other kind of things that they have actually talked about?
So, yes, I do believe, Dilip, that the laws have to keep pace with the newer businesses, and the businesses are changing on a daily basis. But to my mind, any new law or any substantial expansion must be clear in its intent and must be clear as to who it is meant to apply and what are we really taxing. Are we taxing a person? Are we taxing a medium? Or are we taxing a transaction? So while the law came in, effective last year, particularly this equalization level expanded, portion came in last year, despite fair and frequent demand from the industry for FAQs and clarification, there was none provided, and that has been, the law has been expanded retrospectively back from April 2020. And that certainly creates a problem as to where we need to know what the subject matter of the law is. So if it's an intermediation of a transaction and it is intermediating supply of goods which are being delivered offline, should that value of the goods be liable to tax? Or if I book a hotel room in a different part of the world using one of the travel portals, should the hotel value which is being performed outside of India liable to tax in India? I think it has raised tremendous amount of debate. It has expanded in a way that seems extremely artificial. And I think need of the hour is that, yes, on one hand, you want to create a equal, you know, level playing field between domestic service providers and overseas service providers. But to cast the net so wide, where even from day one, we've already set ourselves for immense litigation, is also perhaps something that needs to be looked at more closely to say, are we creating enough certainty and clarity in law? I would be recommending that there should be absolute clarity as to what is meant to be liable and what is not meant to be liable.
So, you know, if I just say the discussion forward, I mean, frankly, if after they have deducted that tax at source, collected at source, if the transaction is found to be not liable, right, they'll refund it. It's not that they will charge you for it or something. And this is really, looking at a perspective of how, significantly what has happened is the travel agents and the other large, and small companies and the single companies, they all were facing the brunt of this. And, you could have an overseas portal actually buying and selling stuff in India, and they were, exempt for this. So what is the solution going forward?
The solution going forward is, one is the tracking of the transaction. If something is, the TDS is not the only mechanism to track transactions in the current world, where the government has upgraded its digital tracking system so, phenomenally, that to say that the only mechanism of tracking a transaction is through a TDS mechanism, it only adds a burden to the taxpayer. The tracking can be done in so many other ways. Secondly, whatever we are facing in India, our e-commerce players are also, transact with other jurisdictions. Are we facing that kind of retaliation from other jurisdictions? We are not facing that. So on one hand, we want to promote use of, digital platforms to intermediate buyer and seller, because that connects a smaller supplier, which doesn't have the, you know, wherewithal of a large marketing capability, can launch itself on various platforms. We as a country have always seen the advantage of that, where product produced in a handicraft or by a small establishment in one part of the country are available seamlessly in another part of the country. We see that. There are mechanisms that were built into GST around it. Now, if that is getting expanded and we have less cash transactions, more transactions which are through digital means, which are far more easy to be tracked, to then create equalization levy, and I'm not saying that that equalization levy should not happen. All my only ask is, and my only recommendation is, there should be no confusion as to what this tax is applicable on. And therefore, any new tax or any substantial expansion of tax should be followed up by an effective clarification, guidance by the what are called taxpayer services, should be followed up so that, you know, we will always have some people who will dispute it and those matters will always go to court. But 95% of the people just want to know the clear law. And I think that should be provided is my recommendation.
So, Rajiv, won't this be covered under the taxpayer's charter? I mean, you know, if you're looking at it, you know, as a taxpayer, if I you know, I have certain rights and other things. So, I mean, do you think that this is something which can be covered under the taxpayer's charter to actually address issues like this? Or do you think it is just a temporary, you know, measure for them to understand the nature and types of transactions that are happening and to then look at an exemption list or a positive list or things like that? Because I think it's a very gray area at the moment. You know, not everybody knows what's happening in that space.
So Dilip, if you were the decision maker and you wanted to administer a new tax, would you first go and cast the net wide and say, I'll catch everybody and then decide who I want to let go? Or would you say, let me study and then I will come out with my clear plan as to who's liable and who's not liable? What, I mean, I don't want to guess your answer, but I would imagine that, you know, we should rather be first prepared and it should be clear as to who's taxable, who's not taxable, rather than cast the net so wide and say, I'm going to catch everyone and then I'll study who I would need to exempt. I think that's what starts. We can't have a law giving rise to dispute with a wide variety of people on day one. Then that means there is something wrong with the way the law is being drafted or administered.
You know, you've talked about the depreciation of goodwill. You've talked about the equalization levy. Is there another area in the budget that could do with some clarity going forward? Another two areas in the budget that could do with some clarity going forward?
So, which is one is a larger point that, you know, we've always, as a country, you know, struggled and, you know, a huge amount of effort and some very exemplary efforts have been made by the government to reduce litigation by coming out with these amnesty schemes. We saw a very successful amnesty scheme for indirect taxes and service tax excise. We've seen a very successful, sort of scheme on Vivad Se Vishwas scheme, which was to do with the corporate tax. And therefore, we wanted a non-litigation environment. At the same time, I see more and more in the law, particularly in the on the GST side, huge amount of powers being given to the tax officers, where every offense is seen as a, you know, a fraud rather than disputes. And we do need to allow for, so while on one hand we see advanced rulings, etc., being, you know, being propagated, but it's almost like if a tax officer were to come to your office, whatever he believes is something that is right, he has immense powers of implementing it right then and there. Whereas what should happen is that there should be a dispute and there should be a dispute resolution mechanism. So I see this growing trend where enormous amount of powers have been given to the officers, including, you know, arrests and you know, suspending your registration and things like that. I think that, you know, giving so many powers to officers for a law that is new for state agencies that are dealing with services for the first time ever and armed with so many powers. I shudder that are they all going to be used in the right spirit or will they be, you know, at times be used for the wrong reasons?
So, you know, the budget, the finance minister also made a statement minimum government, maximum governance, right? So in that context, do you see this as creating a kind of a framework to encourage people not to break the law? Or you think that this goes contrary to that spirit of, minimum government and maximum governance?
So I would not connect it with the, I certainly believe that, the challenges that the tax officers face in terms of any creative, people who do all sorts of funny stuff to evade taxes, and therefore there needs to be suitable and appropriate power. And so therefore I'm not, I encourage and welcome the fact that officers have power to deal with the problem. At the same time, how do we always prevent the misuse of that power? I'm only on that limited point, and therefore clear guidelines. So for instance, in the income tax, we had clear guidelines on saying, when can a, arrest be made? When can a, prosecution be launched? When can a penalty be launched? There are threshold limits that have been prescribed. I would encourage that similar clear guidelines should be there as to, yes, we have the power, but how to not misuse that power? And there should be some clear guidelines as to when a particular power is exercisable. That clarity and a communication program with the taxpayers at large would be will go a long way in saying how these powers do not get misused.
So, is there a lot of debate also happened, on that whole taxation of provident fund, interest on provident fund, right? And, you heard the secretary say that only a very small portion of the taxpayers that will be impacted, and, contrary to that, a lot of the people who are in that class say that, there's no other saving mechanism for us and all. So, is that the right way to address the evasion, or there's some other way that we could have addressed it? Is the 2.5 lakhs, is that the right limit, or what could be done there?
So first and foremost, Dilip, I don't think this case should have ever been treated as a case of evasion. This is all, through provident fund, through a law, I'm required to make a contribution. And therefore, to say that this was being, this was resulting in a fraud, I don't agree with that at all. Yes, were some people using it as a mechanism? Now, you as an investor are entitled to choose which option gives you the best potential return. And therefore, if you've chosen to use more of option A versus option B versus option C, which are all legitimately available, I don't think that should be treated as a irresponsible behavior or as a abusive behavior or a fraud. At the same time, the provident fund is meant to apply and achieve a certain objective. It is a social security, and therefore it is meant to cover the wide variety of people rather than, a certain elite class. I also agree with that larger point of view. I think to cut a threshold of 2.5 lakhs, to my mind, even if you want to do this, is a very small number, because given the large corporate India today, 2.5 lakh is a rather modest amount. If you are trying to say, people with better means ought not to be using this facility, and therefore that number should have been higher, perhaps a case could have been made, and perhaps this would not have seen such an adverse move. Now, whether this number of 2.5 lakhs, should it have been 5 lakhs or 7.5 lakhs, I don't have a precise view on that, but I certainly believe that 2.5 lakhs is actually on the lower side.
I think, thank you very much for this interaction. We've touched a few different areas, the tax on goodwill, the equalization levy, the recent more thing about the provident fund, and of course the overall, challenges of the powers with the tax administrators, particularly referring to the GST side that you have actually talked about. But there's also this whole faceless assessment and faceless appeal has actually also been come in the budget, which is again a positive there if implemented correctly. And I think given your comments, there are some concerns, but nothing with which like the budget, clear, transparent, understanding, execution on the ground cannot solve. So thank you very much for being with us today. And of course, you know, some of these suggestions and comments will be part of the PICCI post-budget memorandum, which has to go out very, very shortly. But thank you very much for being with us today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dilip.